Nature's icons inspire wonder and awe. Some are skyscraper-high mountains, others deep valleys. Some are bodies of water, others dry deserts. Their iconic status is earned by their significance, be it geological, ecological, or cultural. They are places upon which our planet depends. Places shaped by primordial forces, the movement of Earth, the explosion of fire, the weight of ice, the passage of water, and the sculpting of wind. The result is life. To celebrate life on this planet, there is only one place to begin. Galapagos. The Galapagos Islands lie in the eastern Pacific Ocean. The nearest landmass is mainland Ecuador, over 900 kilometers to the east. The archipelago straddles the equator, its islands scattered in both the northern and southern hemispheres. It's an isolated, misshapen place where Mother Nature has bent every rule and experimented with geology and ecology using every tool in her toolbox. The Galapagos was born from fire. The archipelago sits on a hot spot where the Earth's crust is thin and constantly melted from below. Volcanism has been continuous for tens of millions of years. To this day, active volcanoes erupt regularly across the archipelago, and some islands are still being formed. In turn, volcanism colors the Earth. Cliffs of black ash and red iron testify to this fiery history. Beaches are scarred by lava flow and littered with burnt boulders. In stark contrast, the waters are azure blue. This water has had just as much influence on the life of Galapagos as fire and earth. Tropical seas are typically nutrient poor, but the seas of the Galapagos are cooled by the Humboldt current, which is nutrient rich. It enables these islands in the middle of nowhere to be a beacon of life. The number of species living on the Galapagos is small because it's a challenging environment. Resources are limited, so diversity is low. Species evolved to suit a certain niche. This made the archipelago a laboratory of evolution. Out of this laboratory came the blue-footed booby. The name derives from the Spanish word bobo, which means clown-like. Another notable bird is the swallow-tail gull, the only nocturnal gull in the world. Its large, night-adapted eyes enable it to capture fish and squid in the pitch-black ocean. The Galapagos Laboratory also spawned the world's only flightless cormorant. A lack of land predators led to this bird developing non-functional wings. Now they swim instead of fly to find food. Hunting alongside them is the Galapagos penguin, the only species of penguin found north of the equator. Mother Nature's evolutionary experiments captured the attention of naturalist Charles Darwin when he famously visited Galapagos in 1835. Darwin collected many species here, including finches. Their adaptations fascinated him and helped him to formulate his theory of natural selection, which underpins his groundbreaking book On the Origin of Species. This book completely changed how humanity understood the biological evolution of life. Another Galapagos animal that Darwin studied was the giant tortoise. The archipelago once hosted around 15 distinct subspecies of tortoise, each adapted to suit a specific island. It's thought that all these tortoises originated from the same descendants washed to the Galapagos from the mainland millions of years ago. Each subspecies adapted to have its own telltale shell. This shell, named after the Spanish word for saddle, Galapago, gives the islands their name. Sharing equal fame with the tortoise is the marine iguana. According to most biologists, this is the most remarkable animal in the Galapagos. It's the only lizard in the world that goes to sea to feed. Marine iguanas dine on aquatic algae and make their pilgrimage daily. A special pigment in their blood enables them to store oxygen and dive for an hour at a time. Like all reptiles, the marine iguana is cold-blooded. So when they've finished snacking, they need to warm up. To do this, they bunch together to benefit from the combined body temperature. Up close, they resemble dragons. But instead of snorting fire from their nostrils, they expel salt by sneezing. Getting hot under the collar is another way to warm up. In the breeding season from December to April, males wrestle over territory and females. Nodding is a warning. If that doesn't work, then it's an all-out brawl. Females stay out of the way by digging burrows in the sand to lay their eggs. The Galapagos consists of 18 main islands and scores of islets and rocky outcrops. In this volcanic landscape, the brightest splashes of colour are offered by bird life. None more so than the frigate, male frigates have red throat pouches, which brighten in the breeding season. A male uses it to attract the attention of a female. With pouch at the ready, he sits in his chosen nest site and keeps an eye on the sky. If he spots a female, he inflates the pouch and splays his wings, hoping to lure her in. Once bonded, the pair typically raise one chick together and take turns foraging and feeding. Flamingos are also famous for their reddish hue. They love brackish saltwater lagoons and filter feed primarily on brine shrimp. Their beaks and tongues are specially adapted for this unique upside-down eating method. Whilst their color is due to aquatic bacteria and beta-carotene found in their food. A perfect example of you are what you eat. Red rock crabs also burn bright on this blackened coast. The crabs act like garbage collectors, eating whatever debris they find and playing a vital role maintaining a healthy environment. They are super agile, able to run in all directions over any terrain. It earned them the nickname Sally Lightfoot after a Caribbean dancer. Pretty much nothing can catch them. Another slippery character is the sea lion. These Galapagos locals are found in the archipelago year-round. A prime time is August, in the middle of their breeding season. Shorelines are transformed into nurseries full of pups and mums. With no natural predators and top-class protection, the sea lions enjoy a totally chilled-out lifestyle. You don't have to tell these guys to stop and sniff the roses. They do little else. Because the Galapagos remained isolated for so long, its animals have no innate fear of humans. Tolerance of us and one another is all part of the magic of this iconic place. Galapagos is a marine and biosphere reserve and World Heritage Site. In July 2010, the World Heritage Committee reversed its listing as an endangered site due to excellent conservation management. Galapagos shows the world how vital it is to protect the laboratories of life and keep them bubbling away. Another place bursting with extraordinary life is Africa. It's a continent of superlatives. The world's largest, tallest, and fastest animals all come from here. all these animals are found in Africa's most famous park, the Serengeti. The Serengeti National Park is located in central Tanzania and covers an area of 15,000 square kilometers. It's revered as one of the planet's greatest wilderness areas. Hundreds of species coexist here. Herbivores include numerous types of antelope and gazelle. While carnivores include the elusive leopard. There are over 500 bird species, from delicate songbirds to the messy cleanup crew. Vultures play a vital role dispatching carcasses that would otherwise rot and spread disease. It's dirty work, but someone has to do it. The plant life of the Serengeti National Park forms one of the oldest and most scientifically significant ecosystems on Earth. Over 300 plant species are found in the park, some with ancient heritage. Many different habitats make up the Serengeti, from open grassland to forests, woodlands and plains, dominated by acacia and sausage trees. These trees provide sustenance for vegetarians like giraffes, who expertly pick out the leaves from the thorns. Around 200,000 visitors converge on the Serengeti each year, mostly in search of wildlife. It's easily found, sometimes right in the tire rut. Other times, right in front of the windscreen. For wildebeest, the grass is always greener on the other side. On the other side of the road and country. And finding fresh grass fuels this, the world's greatest land migration. Every year, more than 1.5 million wildebeest run from the Serengeti Plains to Kenya's Masai Mara and back again, a round trip of some 1,000 kilometers. Other grazers join them, including zebra and antelope. All told, over 8 million hooves thunder across the Serengeti in a living chain. This wonder of Earth is triggered by water. The animals literally chase the rain and the sustenance it promises. It's do or die. Around 250,000 wildebeest perish during each migration from exhaustion, hunger, thirst, and predation. Tanzania experiences just 4 rainy months, with April and May the rainiest. Five rivers cut through the Serengeti National Park, fueled by these seasonal downpours. African animals of all shapes and sizes stick close to this water and depend upon it. The standout water beast is the African buffalo. It's known as Black Death or Widowmaker due to its dangerous nature. The main thing to remember is never get between a buffalo and the river. They must drink every day to survive and also love the water reeds and grasses. In the Serengeti, buffalo are thriving and can sometimes be found in herds of 1,000 or more. It takes a brave beast to cut a swathe through buffalo. Brave and big. This is the world's largest land creature, the African elephant. Boss of the herd is the matriarch, often with youngsters afoot. Bond between mother and calf is one of the strongest in the natural world. It starts with a long pregnancy of 22 months and continues for years after birth. Even when nursing a young calf, the matriarch stays connected with older calves. It's really just one big happy family. The name elephant originates from the Greek word elephas, meaning ivory. It shows what they're most valued for, and poaching for their tusks has decimated the species. Thanks to decades of protection, over 7,000 elephants roam the Serengeti National Park, making it a rare good news story for the species. They are earth shakers and movers. Everything they do alters their environment. And they are sustained by their environment in all different ways. Elephants love to make the dirt fly. Earth minerals supplement their diet, and dust is applied as sunscreen and insect repellent. African elephants can live for 70 years in the wild, and as adults, they have no natural predators. But calves do. The lions of the Serengeti specialize in killing elephants and target the young ones. A male lion is strong enough to bring one down on his own, but is famous for conserving energy, unless absolutely necessary. The name Serengeti is derived from the Maasai word Siringit, meaning endless plains. On these plains, even Africa's biggest and tallest are tiny. These weird and wonderful life forms exist in a sort of time capsule here. Weather, flora, and fauna has barely changed on the Serengeti for over a million years. This is a prehistoric place where life has breathing room. As the Serengeti shows, given enough space, life has no limits. And Africa's water equivalent is the Pacific Ocean. It's the largest and deepest ocean on Earth. It covers over 30% of the world's surface and is bigger than the land masses of all the world's continents combined. Its average depth is 4,000 meters, but the infamous Mariana Trench reaches a depth of 11,000 meters. That's over 2,000 meters deeper than Everest is high. On the surface, the Pacific is an idyllic, glittering playground. Most of the world's islands are found in this ocean. Over 25,000 of them. On any of these postcard-perfect islands, it's easy to understand why its name, Pacific, derives from the Spanish word for peaceful. But when it comes to life, the Pacific is anything but peaceful. This ocean supports wildlife galore. Wilderness gems are scattered across this mighty ocean. Shining brightest is Palau. To its west is the Philippines. To its south is Indonesia and Papua New Guinea. But Palau is hundreds of kilometers from all of these places. It literally sits in the middle of nowhere, surrounded by water. Palau consists of 340 islands. The most famous are these mushroom-shaped creations called rock islands. They're remnants of an ancient coral reef which grew millions of years ago when sea level was some 250 meters higher. Tectonic activity pushed the reef to the surface. Exposed coral eroded, leaving chunks of limestone. Wave action sculpts the base, while jungle stabilizes the top, resulting in these distinct shapes. Most of Palau's islands are uninhabited, so the main life here is wildlife. In this tropical climate, where rainfall and humidity is high and temperatures stable, that life is abundant. Above and below the surface. This is also because of a long, strong history in conservation. It began in 1956 with the protection of many of the islands. And it hit a high point in 2009 when Palau created the world's first shark sanctuary. The sanctuary is approximately 600,000 square kilometers of ocean, an area the size of France. With commercial fishing banned, these waters offer a safe house for 130 species of shark, which are fighting extinction in the wider Pacific Ocean. The World Future Council cites Palau as a global leader in protecting marine ecosystems. And it's also a UNESCO World Heritage Site. Even the scars of war are beautified here. During World War II, Palau was caught in the crossfire between American and Japanese forces. Airstrikes pummeled the area for months, downing planes and sinking dozens of ships, turning Palau into a watery graveyard. But nature quickly resurrected life after death. Wreckage is now festooned with living reef and a diver's delight. Soft corals decorate artillery and guns. Fish drift along decks. And everyday items used by soldiers now rest in peace. In the shallows, there's even a chance to experience flying a fighter plane. Ecotourism makes the most of humanity's darkest hours, and the natural and alien seamlessly coexist in all sorts of ways in Palau. Another example is here on Ale Mulk Island, in the famous Jellyfish Lake. Few creatures look as otherworldly as these glowing golden jellyfish. And they really are out of place in their jungle setting. Normally, jellyfish are adrift in the open ocean, but these ones get the best of both worlds. Their lake is connected to the outside ocean via fissures in the island's limestone. Fresh ocean water enters and leaves on the tides. But the lake is isolated enough to create its own unique conditions, and the jellyfish have adapted. They're substantially different from close relatives in other lagoons and now appear to be their own subspecies. They have no predators, so have lost their stinging cells. And whether they boom or bust depends entirely on drought or rain and the lake's salinity. Zooxanthellae algae live in their tissues and photosynthesize sunlight for energy. This nourishes the host jellyfish in a symbiotic relationship. The algae's need for sunlight drives the movement of the jellyfish. Starting at sunrise, the jellyfish follow the arc of the sun from one side of the lake to the other. They move by pumping water through their bells and rotate to expose their entire bodies to the light. Hundreds of thousands of jellyfish take part in this daily migration. Jellyfish Lake is around 12,000 years old. It's a remnant of the last ice age, a basin filled by higher seas. As glaciers receded and sea level dropped, the jellyfish were trapped. How they adapted would make Darwin proud. Like the Galapagos, the lake is another laboratory of evolution, pulsing with life. The richness of life on our planet has a distinct pattern. In very simple terms, the closer to the equator, the greater the biodiversity. The closer to the poles, the more diminished. Scientifically, this is a known phenomenon called the latitudinal diversity gradient. It's thought rainfall in the tropics is the main driver of life. Species blossom, compete for space, and diversify. Straddling this tropical belt, with a wildlife biodiversity the envy of the world, is the Indonesian archipelago. The archipelago lies off Southeast Asia in the Indian and Pacific Oceans. It consists of 17,500 islands with a total area of 1.9 million square kilometers. That's almost 8 times bigger than the UK and spanning a distance greater than the width of North America. This makes Indonesia the world's largest island country. Geologically, the archipelago is one of the most unusual areas in the world. It lies on the Pacific Ring of Fire, a major juncture in the Earth's tectonic plates where volcanic and seismic activity is high. Evidence of fire is everywhere. But all the icon makers have been busy here. Coupled with fire, the uplift of Earth has resulted in a fertile, dramatic landscape, which sustains one of the world's richest floral habitats. Water and wind have also played their part, carving ancient limestone into spectacular coastlines and caves. And the coming and going of ice ages influenced the migration and evolution of both animals and people. For millennia, the archipelago has been a nexus for people of mainland Asia and across Oceania. It's a melting pot of more than 300 different ethnic groups, almost 700 distinct languages, and a mix of both major and indigenous religions. As far as human life goes, the Indonesian archipelago is booming. With a population of over 276 million, it is one of the most densely populated places on Earth. But, despite the press of humanity, wildlife abounds here. Around 7,000 islands are still uninhabited, and the warm, monsoonal climate makes the archipelago a cauldron of biodiversity. Some islands even have their own star animals. One is legendary. The Komodo dragon. This is the world's largest lizard. It can grow up to a length of 3 meters and weigh around 70 kilos. It's endemic to Indonesia, with Komodo Island its stronghold. The same elemental forces which created iconic Indonesia created this living monster. Its lineage is ancient, going back some 20 million years. It's thought the species we see today actually originated in Australia around 3 million years ago. Reptilian megafauna were once common throughout Australasia. But by the end of the last ice age, only a few species like the Komodo remained, scattered on isolated islands. Feasting on everything from birds to mammals to carrion, the Komodo dragon rose in fame to become an apex predator. It's even killed a few humans. Meanwhile, the star species of Borneo is much more peace-loving. It hides out in the thick jungle as best it can. When spotted, it's quite an eyesore. The proboscis monkey is Indonesia's Pinocchio, famous for the male's unusually long nose. This nose can exceed 10 centimeters and is thought to be visually attractive to females and also magnifies vocalizations. The proboscis monkey is only found on this island and is classified as endangered. Its survival can only be assured in places like this, Labuk Bay Monkey Sanctuary. The sanctuary is 400 acres of precious forest, spared whilst the rest was felled for a palm oil plantation. It's just enough room to offer a semi-wild existence for its 150 monkeys and keep them in good health. It's also a safe place to raise the next generation. Sharing the same uncertain fate is the orangutan. Once widespread throughout the forests of Asia, this famous primate is now found on just two islands, Borneo and Sumatra. The orangutan's name translates to person of the forest. But like the proboscis monkey, it relies heavily on protected sanctuaries to keep a tenuous hold on survival. This is the most famous animal of Indonesia's archipelago and one of our closest relatives in the animal kingdom. They share over 97% of our genes and are highly intelligent. Orangutans are unique life forms, the only great ape in Southeast Asia and the only one found outside of Africa. All life began in the ocean around 4 billion years ago. Since that time, life has continued to spawn here. And one of the ocean's most important nurseries are coral reefs. Australia's Great Barrier Reef is the mother of all coral reefs. This is the world's largest coral reef system, stretching over 2,300 kilometres and covering an area of more than 344,000 square kilometres. Layer by layer, over millions of years, the reef has grown to become the largest living structure on the planet, and the only one visible from outer space. The Great Barrier Reef consists of 3,000 individual reefs, over 600 islands, and 300 coral caves. It's a vast matrix of life, which has the smallest of beginnings. Corals. Corals are ancient beings which have inhabited planet Earth for over 500 million years. Some species are fast-growing and resemble branches, such as the aptly named staghorn corals. Meanwhile, brain corals are slow-growing and can live for hundreds of years. Others are hungry for the sun and spread outwards to form plates and fans. These different species then jostle for light and space and intermingle to become the reef. The Great Barrier Reef is part of a vast World Heritage listed area. 70 million football fields would fit inside its marine park. A quarter of all known marine species spent part of their life cycle on a reef. They range from the cryptic to the charismatic. Over 1,600 fish species live on the Great Barrier Reef. Each fish species depends on the reef in different ways for shelter, habitat, and food. Herbivores like wrasse actually chew on coral to extract the algae for nutrition, and then poo out the sand. This sand accumulates into the famous picture-perfect white beaches, which in turn creates habitat for other creatures, including more than 200 bird species. For most, the life of the Great Barrier Reef appears never-ending, but that's an illusion. The increase of water temperature due to climate change causes coral to bleach more often and die. Scientists predict that by around 2040, our beloved icon will be lifeless. Sea turtles offer hope. They are Earth's living dinosaurs, unchanged for over 100 million years. To see turtles on the Great Barrier Reef is a reminder of the resilience of life on Earth, evolving and adapting despite the greatest of odds. Over millions of years, corals have been destroyed and reborn countless times. So, if this history is anything to go by, the Great Barrier Reef may yet rise again. As the fate of the Great Barrier Reef reminds us, planet Earth is in constant flux. It has already experienced five mass extinction events, during which 70 to 95% of all life was extinguished. Scientists say we are now entering our sixth mass extinction event. This time, it's not caused by Earth's elemental forces, instead, by humankind. But humankind is but a blip on the geological timeline. The icons of Earth, fire, ice, water, and wind precede us by thousands, sometimes millions of years, and will continue to be created in perpetuity, beyond our control, beyond our imagination. Such is the way for the world's greatest icons of nature.